the round table that we want to have, or the discussion that we'd like to have, is really about how do we address climate change and its effects, which are accelerating and are bringing an urgent and desperate need for practical responses and adaptation options for farmers. I think the message that I'm getting from most of the people that I'm talking to is that the accelerating climate change urgently requires inclusive processes to co-develop scalable strategies to enhance smallholder farmers' adaptive capacity. The farmers do not have the luxury of waiting for us to figure everything else out. They need a response now. And however, if we're going to have a response, we can't just jump into action without having proper knowledge and information. And what we hope to do today is to curate a conversation that will allow us, I think, to start to explore what some of those options look like. What I would like to point your attention as well is the fact that today we have released this brief, which is called Agronomic Adaptive Strategies to Strengthen Smallholder Resilience to Climate Change. It's available outside, so grab a copy, and there'll also be online availability as well on our site. But the issue that we think is very important for us to think about now is, what are those frameworks that we need to be deploying using agronomy and agronomic solutions to increase farmers' adaptive capacities? And so as an initiative, Excellence in Agronomy, which is what I represent, has been thinking a lot about how do we bring agronomy to become part of the solution to deliver sustainable intensification and climate change adaptation. A lot of the research that we do within the CG is focused on breeding, developing varieties that are fit for purpose in different climates. But I think you'll agree with me that the agronomy part is the missing element in terms of what farmers are adopting. In many countries, whether you are looking at Southeast Asia or in some parts of Africa, farmers have already taken up some of the hybrids, the varieties that are out there, but we're not getting the yields. I made mention this morning that where I come from in Southern Africa, we have some of the worst maize yields for countries that have the kind of agroclimatic conditions that we have. If you look at Zimbabwe or Zambia or Malawi, huge investments in inputs and fertilizer, but really struggling to go beyond 1 ton per hectare in terms of yield. So there's clearly a problem in terms of how farmers are adopting the agronomy part, which is really about the crop, soil, water and nutrient management side of the equation. So it's important for us that as we are having this conversation around creating opportunities for farmers for adaptation, we recognize that the biggest frontier that we'll have to overcome is the uptake of agronomic practices by farmers at scale. So for us, we think that if you look at the impact areas that we as the CG are trying to address, there's a space for agronomy everywhere. But it's important, I think, to define what it is that we're trying to achieve. And for us, we believe that what we really need to achieve is this concept of agronomic gain. The breeders can easily see what genetic gain looks like, but do we have metrics that we can use to measure the concept of agronomic gain? And what would fit into an agronomic gain framework? We think issues of yield, yield stability, and yield profitability are definitely part of the equation. Secondly, we think resource use efficiency, when we're looking at labor, when we're looking at nutrients, when we're looking at water, and we've got a colleague who will talk about water issues today. there is definitely a need for us to be able to measure how farmers are improving that efficiency. When we look at soil and soil health, this is a big, big issue, particularly in most parts of the continent because of land degradation. How are we making it possible for smallholder farmers to be part of the solution and to be the agents for soil health management? And then I think finally, why we are here today, which is the issue of climate adaptation, how do we realistically measure that and be able to show that farmers are moving in the right direction? You'll agree with me that all these things are intertwined. They need to somehow connect because the yield and profitability agenda really depends on the quality of the soil. So if we're not doing soil health management, we're not going to make it. But it's also about the inputs that are going into production. Often we are making recommendations as scientists for farmers to adopt practices which are actually not profitable for them. So how do we find the balance between the resource use efficiency and the profitability agenda, and ultimately strengthening farmers' climate resilience as a whole? So like I said, we've launched this paper, and in this paper there are a few concepts that we'd like to introduce and to bring to your attention. The first one is that adaptation is now an imperative. We do not have a choice. Farmers are experiencing the impacts now. They need stuff that they can put to use immediately. What are those options? How do we get there? But it also requires that we think a little bit differently about agronomy itself, about how we package the solutions, about how we deliver the solutions, about how we measure use and uptake of those solutions. So we need to reimagine what agronomy in the era of climate change is actually going to look like. And then I think we need to find the entry points for agronomic adaptation. What are those entry points? Because not all farmers are the same. Not all contexts are the same. How do we become context specific and appropriate and be able to deliver these adaptation solutions in a manner that can actually bring about change? So that's something that is important. We've tried to package this in a way that says, well, there's a time scale to this. Farmers need immediate solutions now that will impact this season, but they also need solutions that over time will start to move their resilience in the right direction. And ultimately, we need system actions that require participation of governments and states to deliver some of this change. And when we look at this typology, what we realize is that there are a number of solutions which we can map to specific situations or risks or hazards. And that's what we've tried to do in this paper, and I hope when you take a look at it, you'll be able to give us some meaningful comments about the direction of the thinking that we have come up with. So we've chosen to do a lot of this work in demand-driven use cases, because the mistake, I think, that we have done as the CG over time is that we do good research, we put it in a bottle, and then we try and take it to farmers, and then we wonder why they are not taking it up. What if we started with understanding where their pain points are? What immediate solutions they see for themselves, and then we can bring some wraparound support from CG Science to respond to challenges they are facing now. And I think that by taking this demand-driven approach, we can get closer to achieving some of the impact that we need. So we've got some use cases that this initiative has been working on, and there's 20 of them right now across the world, in the 6 regions of the world, in Latin America, in North Africa and Central West Asia, in West and Central Africa, in East and Southern Africa, and in Asia, we are working in Southeast Asia and also in South Asia. trying as much as possible to first of all identify the needs, build the CG science around that particular problem, and co-create the solutions. And there are examples that I would like to share that are quite close to where we are. Here in Egypt, our teams are working on what I think is probably one of the most innovative approaches to try and understand how the Nile Delta is experiencing yield variability and how we can respond to that in real time on a season-to-season basis. So the team that's working there is our colleagues from ICADA together with CIMIT, working with the Agriculture Research Council here in Egypt to come up with a platform which is digital that can be very location-specific in about giving the season-on-season yield variability that farmers are experiencing, and then be able to point out areas across the country that are experiencing a sustained decline in yields, and then we can act in a targeted manner and move away from being blanket focused. So I think there's some really good work being done here. But also in this region in Morocco, and we had a very good talk earlier this week, in Morocco they are trying to respond to climate change by pushing conservation agriculture at a scale that has not been seen before. They are targeting 1 million hectares to bring 1 million hectares into mechanized conservation agriculture across Morocco. This is a huge and ambitious a plan that they are putting in place, but it's complicated. It's about, first of all, finding the scale-appropriate equipment, developing a service delivery model that works for Morocco, and then showing the farmers the evidence that if they make this investment, there's going to be a benefit in the end. Already we are seeing that farmers who are practicing CA, there's less yield variability in spite of the variability on the climate side. So it's starting to work, but can we take it to scale? This is one of the things that we are trying to do. So, in a nutshell, what I hope we can do this afternoon is to really have a meaningful conversation that tries to unpack, what are some of the options out there from an adaptation perspective, basing it from agronomy. And we've got a very esteemed panel who I'm going to be inviting shortly to go onto the stage. And our panel is made up of representation from not only the CG itself, but also from government entities, and also from some of our partner UN organizations. So I'm going to call upon my panelists by name and ask them to come onto the stage. I'm going to start with my colleague, Adithi, if you could come onto the stage, please. And then I'm also going to invite Lorenzo from the WFP, if you could also come up. And then I'm going to also invite Madam Veronica Ndetu from the ministry, the head of climate change at the Ministry of Agriculture in Kenya. And then online, we've got a colleague of mine, Peter Benhu Nyiko, who will be joining us all the way from Uganda. Hopefully we can see Peter. Hi, Peter. Fantastic. So I think I'm going to start off by, we need a microphone.
Do you have a microphone?
You okay? Okay. All right. Fantastic. I'm going to start off with you, Peter, as you are joining us online. You can have the first bite of the cherry. You are working in northern Uganda, an area that probably has some of the highest agricultural potential in East Africa. However, if we look back over the last two decades, issues of food and nutrition security have really been a challenge. But not only has there been an issue of food and nutrition security, there's been also energy challenges, infrastructure challenges, and your organization is trying to respond to that at scale. Could you maybe share very briefly, as you introduce the work that you do, some of the initiatives that Mandulis Energy has started in northern Uganda in trying to combine good agronomic practices and all the other things that the farmers need, in particular energy, ecosystem services, etc. If you could kick us off, please. Peter?
Thank you very much. It's great to be back in Egypt virtually. Good evening, everyone, to our Egyptian brothers. Masa al khair, sayyidati, anisati, sadati. Masa al fulli wal yasmin li kulla shiqaina min al nil. Thank you very much. I thought I'd say that. So in Uganda, at Mandulis Energy, we've been around for the last 10 years.
Okay.
And we're working in rural northern Uganda with farmers that work on crops such as maize, beans, groundnut, rice, etc. What we realized was just using the residues from agricultural value addition, such as maize cobs, rice husks, and groundnut shells, as well as residues, you know, which are more decomposable, we're able to generate electricity. We first of all generate methane and hydrogen gas that runs engines to produce electricity, but the residues that remain in that process are things such as biochar and nutrient-rich bioslurry. When you blend the bioslurry from anaerobic digestion and the biochar from gasification, you have a very rich soil enhancer, which is a residue from our power generation, but concurrently allows farmers to improve their yields at a low cost. But the electricity that we generate is high quality electricity in rural areas, but at below the price that they would have otherwise, you know, had from any other source, actually on par with the grid. So we have got two locations that are running right now in northern Uganda, where we're powering agricultural value addition, where we're, you know, enhancing agricultural inputs such as bio fertilizer, organic fertilizer, etc., from the residues. We've got electric vehicles that are replacing diesel and petrol vehicles in communities that are more than 30 kilometers away from the nearest petrol station anyway. And we've got mini grids that are, you know, connecting the community to electricity so that they are able to do more than just farm. And what's happened as a result of that is the communities where we are working, incomes have gone up, businesses have flourished, homes have been built, and we're scaling up to even more locations in Uganda. By this time next year, we'll be in an additional four locations. So it's been an exciting one. But what's great here is, while rural farms are able to get access to cooking fuel at, you know, very affordable costs, electricity and other things and so on and so forth, our innovations include what enables the residues that come from our users who are farmers to be linked to industries that need them, such as cement industry using biochar. That's a residue from, you know, farmers cooking, such as, you know, breweries and, you know, and beverage companies replacing heavy fuel oil with agricultural residues and so on and so forth. But beyond that, when they're able to access value addition and the high qualities that come out of that, they can meet the global standards needed to supply large multinationals, and therefore their incomes go up higher. And it's a circular loop, turns rural farmers from customers into stakeholders that help us, you know, green the ecosystem for industrial players that are connected to us. Thank you.
Thanks a lot, Peter. I think you're already starting to answer one of my questions, which is it possible to really utilize the fact that smallholder farmers have got access to land, they've got access to assets, that can not only improve the health of their soils, but also give them access to other needs such as energy, etc. So we'll explore that a little bit further in a short while. But I'm really keen to hear a public sector perspective, Madam Veronica, because you sit at the climate change unit within the Ministry of Agriculture in Kenya. And we know that the government of Kenya, in partnership with the World Bank, has made a huge investment in creating probably the biggest big data platform, on top of which service providers are able to build services to farmers, particularly from an agronomy support perspective. As the climate change unit, do you think that this kind of investment has been essential, and is it sustainable? Can you keep it up? And is it really attracting the kind of interest from service providers to then use the information that you have to serve the farmers better? Your thoughts?
Yes, thank you so much for having me in this forum. Yes, Kenya embraces climate smart agriculture as the approach through which to implement both its adaptation and mitigation goals. And so the World Bank project that is called Climate Smart Agriculture Project is one of the initiatives that there are in Kenya to ensure that the country is moving towards a low, the agriculture sector in the country is moving through a low carbon development pathway. And this is through initiatives that ensure that the farmers, first of all, get they adapt to the impacts of climate change. They also get food security from implementing the interventions at their farm level. And they also more so access the information that they require, because as the climate continues to change, the farmers need to get information on time so that they can be able to do their operational or farm operations timely. And so the big data and the data that is at CALRO that has been developed through this process is very useful. It provides SMS advisory services that through messages on the phone, and the farmer can be able to access information on whether they are going to get rains or not within the next 7 days. And that is very useful to the farmer because it gives them an opportunity to make decisions on what they need to do. So this is very useful because it is really helps the farmers to make decisions. On the question on whether it is sustainable, we believe it can be sustainable because I think in Kenya, the climate change issues, not only in agriculture, but across the whole country are taken very seriously. There is proper good coordination between the Minister of Environment, the Kenya Meteorological Department that provides that information, and then the sector interprets it into the useful information to the farmers. This has also happened even without the World Bank project, and that's why I believe that it is sustainable. And once it becomes the norm, then other institutions, including the government, will take responsibility and ensure that it happens. Thank you.
Thank you so much, Madam Veronica. I think you make an important point that in order for us to be able to provide these services to farmers, we need multiple players to come to the party. You have a role as government to create the basic infrastructure, but it really only works if there are people using that data infrastructure to then deliver our services to farmers. What she's not saying to you is that Kenya has actually geotagged over 2 million smallholder farmers, and that's the information that's sitting on this big data platform, which then other service providers can build on top of. If I can maybe come to you, Adithi, around you are sitting in the climate change impact area at a CG level. When you look across the CG, and you look at some of the solutions that are coming up from our scientists, what do you think we need to do to make them fit for purpose, readily accessible, and to then power up the basic infrastructure that entities like the Minister of Agriculture in Kenya have built already? What role can we play as the CG to really drive this agronomic gain agenda and improve adaptation?
Thank you so much, Mandel, for a wonderful question. I have recently started my role as a director of the CGIAR Climate Change Platform. And wearing that hat, I think, answering to your question, I mean, there are a lot of innovations that we as CG scientists, as well as our partners, are doing in the field of agronomy. And I think the approach you said, that it has to be demand-led, I think that's the way to go. You know, so the demand-led one with the partners, if you're developing and co-developing them together, some of the work that I'm also involved in another regional initiative called TAFSA, and I see Amjad is here. So in TAFSA also, we are following a very similar approach to what you are following in the EIA. And I believe most of our CGIAR initiatives are actually now following that kind of a demand-based approach where we are co-developing these technologies along with our partners. Our official from ma'am from Kenya, you are saying, I think that's tremendous that the ministry itself is, you know, taking charge of the geotagging of the farmers and creating the database. But if you allow me a minute, I also wanted to wear my another hat, which is as IPCC scientist, and talk about a little bit of the assessment that we did. We actually looked at many of these agronomic practices are actually adaptation measures with sometimes mitigation co-benefits. So in the entire working group report, we were interested in answering this question, like how effective is adaptation in reducing climate risk? And when we started doing the assessment, and this was a long time, we only kind of look at the peer-reviewed publications. What we found was, like, we can see that many of these measures, all adaptation, including agronomic measures, have a lot of benefits. But what we are really missing out is that evidence base that actually says that the benefits are reducing risk. So, and that's what I think as CG scientists over the next 7 years, 10 years, we have to actually generate that evidence, because there's a gap. We don't know if a certain agronomic practice is reducing vulnerability, if it's reducing exposure to those climate change events. So that's the one point where I think we have a knowledge gap and we have a huge responsibility to fill that up. The other part of the assessment, we found that many of these adaptation methods, adaptation responses, including agronomic ones, you know, in even seed variety ones, actually become ineffective at a higher level of global warming. And here we have been hearing about, like, you know, 1.5 is dead. We simply cannot let 1.5 to be dead, because when 1.5 is dead, with it is many of our toolkit in our adaptation box also goes dead, because there's simply no way that many of our adaptation can work in a really warm world, 2 degrees and beyond. So I think that's where also we as a CG scientist owe to generate more evidence that kind of feeds into this narrative that crossing 1.5 degree is simply not an option for the farmers and the smallholder, you know, pastoralists and the agricultural and farmers that we work with. So I'll stop there and, yeah.
I think you really are hitting the nail on the head, that the thing that we can do and do well as CG scientists is to be able to identify the challenges and the risks and then provide the solutions, but also the evidence that these solutions actually work. Now, Lorenzo, you have the unenviable position of having in your organization to deal with the real impact at farmer and household level of this climate change conversation that we are having. If you look at the households that the WFP typically supports, what is the missing element? Why are we, as maybe the CG, failing to transfer the good knowledge, the good evidence that sits in our scientific research institutes to that farmer in that village? what should we be taking into the field that would make your job redundant in time?
Mandel, that's a great question, and really, like our job as WFP, I mean, we're working in the most food insecure and fragile context. Our job is actually not to make ourselves needed in the next 10 to 15 years. Whether this will happen or not depends on a lot of things, including our work. But this will be the aim, and I mean, we really appreciate this question because it's fundamental. I mean. The populations, the people that we're working with are really at the borderline in terms of at the front line in terms of climate change. But climate change for many of them is in a sense already a luxury because their land is already degraded. Maybe they are in a conflict situation, the economic crisis, price shocks, you name it. It's all there. So like. In WFP, what we're trying to do is to provide like an integrated response. That, and what you showed here, like in terms of EIA, like really resonates because it's really integrated, where we support communities providing immediate food assistance, but then like support the land restoration, the soil management of these communities, providing linking them to markets. In providing support in terms of like school feeding, so that not only we're looking at the food security of the current populations, the current communities, but also what is happening in the future. And what we could do, I mean, what are like some of the shortcomings in terms of agronomy? I mean, one of the first issues is really like reaching out to people. So like. Like how do you manage like in extreme situation to change these practices? And so like the food assistance incentive, for example, in some context can work, but that's not enough. What is really needed also is like community-based participation, being with the people, understanding what are the needs, understanding the context, but also providing the right agronomic
solutions,
tools.
Yeah.
The right solutions, which most of the time are pretty simple. I mean, we're talking about composting, which yeah. I hope also in the plus 1.5 degree scenario could still be working. We're talking about no-till, keeping like the soil covered, integrated rangeland management, and all these type of things, which are not rocket science, but we need support in bringing this to these vulnerable people, working with agricultural extension experts, working with governments, working with local NGOs to send this message. Like,
I think you've really raised a number of important points, and what I'm taking away from you is that we're probably not doing enough engagement with the farmers themselves to understand what their needs are and how we can actually strengthen some of their assets, their livelihood assets. And one of those livelihood assets is obviously human capital. There's physical capital, there's financial capital, but there's also social capital, their ability to make decisions and decisions for themselves. I mean, Peter, if I can move back to you online, you have a very complicated environment in that it's a post-conflict zone where ultimately people just want to survive until the next day. How do you create the incentives for farmers to even keep crop residues, make them available to mandulis, trust that you are not just going to get carbon credits and make good money and disappear, and that you'll actually deliver some ecosystem services back to them? How do you convince them? How do you bring the agency of the farmer into the conversation in your experience as mandulis?
Thank you very much. I think what we basically focus on is, just as Lorenzo said, we reach out to the community. We involve them from the very beginning. We involve the community in site selection. We involve the community in baseline studies and feasibility studies, environmental and social impact assessments. We involve the community at every step of our project development. So they know what theories we bring forward. They chip in with what they know how to do already. And they chip in with what we can do together to make what they know already even better. And we go a step further. Any off-taker that we propose to the community, we actually bring them over to the community, be they a service provider like a bank, or be they an off-taker of a crop. We make sure the senior representatives from those entities come to that village, including those who buy carbon offsets from us. The villagers build trust when they know that we've involved them in every step of the way. And and we involve young people from those communities and train them, build their capacity to be part of our technical team as well. So when they're part of what we do all the way through, they're not surprised with whatever happens. They're well informed, they've been part of the decision making. And yeah, and they, you know, even when it comes to new investors coming on board, they already will have met the community will have met them, and they will know what they're in for. But having a community totally involved from the get-go means it's a lot easier to grow, a lot easier to scale, and a lot easier to have that buy-in that's necessary to have a very successful project. And so secondly, whatever we propose, we've got to pilot it alongside them. So if we talk about involving biochar in the soil to improve the soil water retention, capacity, we do it on a couple of acres with a community. They see that. Then they replicate in the following season what they've seen us do already. If we talk about composting, if we talk about involving biochar and composting, if we talk about agricultural residues coming through the digester and the slurry that comes out being used as a soil enhancer, all of that, they're part of it. The stoves that we give to the community, they see us use it first. And we even involve the grandmothers, in the trainings. So when families sit around the fireplace at the end of the evening, the elders in the community will tell the younger ones exactly, how things used to be in the old days and how some of the interesting innovations we've come up with links up with what they already know. They can compare gasification stoves to charcoal making, for example, and they can look at how composting links with what they may have done traditionally. And so that's kind of what it comes down to. Reaching out and involving the community every step of the way. Thank you.
Thanks a lot, Peter, for that. If I can come back to you, Madam Veronica, sitting at a policy implementation level, some people might say, well, you are too far removed from what's really going on the ground. What is the government of Kenya, for example, doing to make sure that the climate adaptation agenda is not only just a policy of government, but something that the grandmother in her shamba is actually thinking about and is actually practicing and is also influencing some of the decisions that you are making? What have you done as the Kenyan government to build that connection with where the farmers are and where the policy and the policy making is sitting?
Thank you. Yes, the policies are made so that they can facilitate the farmers to do what needs to be done. And so much as I am, actually the idea of having a climate change units in the all state agencies of the government of Kenya is to ensure that climate change issues are mainstreamed from the top to the bottom to the implementation. And so the policy provides broad statements on what needs to be done. But then that is, if it remains there, as you have rightly said, it will not be done. But we have a very very clear way of cascading that information through the counties. As you know, that our government, we have two levels, the national government and the county government. The implementation is actually done by the counties. And so the first thing that you do is, or that we do, is to ensure that the counties domesticate the national policies. For example, in agriculture, we have the climate smart agriculture strategy and its implementation framework. Now, through that, we have a process that uses a multi-stakeholder platform to ensure that there is cascading of these two policy documents to the county level. And then the stakeholders, because it's not only government that gives information to farmers, there are also very many other stakeholders that do extension and provide extension services to farmers. And so the key purpose of the ministry at the national level is to ensure that those who actually reach the farmers have that information. And so it is to ensure that everybody does their role in terms of making the policy, taking the policy down, and because farmers implement practices, not policies, then telling
That's
farmers
a good one, yeah.
These are the necessary practices, yeah. And as guided by the policies. And so this is it has to go all the way to the ground, and then it comes back because you need feedback from the farmers also, so that they tell you this does not work. This one you have put in the policy but does not work. So that they give you that feedback, and then this is what informs the review of policies or what you need to do. So I think that process is really put in place in Kenya. Yeah. There's a lot of trainings, capacity building at the county level and at the grassroots level. Thank you.
I think what I really like about your response is that you make the point that we have to be deliberate about creating feedback mechanisms from the ground. And the quote of the day is, farmers implement practices and not policies. I think that's brilliant. Adithi, I mean, you work a lot also in the water space. And one of the resource use efficiency targets that we have set for ourselves as Excellence in Agronomy is improving, you know, the efficiency or the efficient use of water in agricultural systems. Isn't that just a very complicated term that would be very difficult for farmers to actualize on the ground? What are we as the CG doing to make sure that agenda in particular is also able to be done by an ordinary farmer out there in the shambas? What are we doing to make these policies or practices actually implementable? Yeah. With regards to water use efficiency, yeah.
No, that's an absolutely a very important question. And a scientist, is easy to say that farmers should do efficient use of water, but then, farmers at the end of the day are trying to maximize their incomes. They are not often as concerned about the resource base, because for them that's one part of the input. So we cannot just assume that because we want efficient use of water, it will automatically follow. I think what's important is many of the times water use is not efficient because of the policies that are involved. I mean, either in regions there's just, you know, enough water resource, nobody thinks of water as a constraint. But what we are also seeing at the work that we do at EMI and also the work that all of our partners do everywhere is that you can incentivize farmers to increase their water use efficiency, and that incentive actually works where water is a physical scarcity. So trying to provide incentives where there is plenty of water is like, duh, farmers don't really see why they need to save water. But then when you are actually in a region where water is physically scarce, then these kind of incentive structures actually work quite well. So I feel that apart from doing things on the ground in terms of agronomic practices, this needs to actually loop back to the ministries that, you know, these kind of policies. Very often water is free, farmers don't really get the scarcity value of water. So how do you, you know, and pricing water is often very complicated. You cannot directly price water, but perhaps you can have indirect kind of incentives through maybe electricity tariff, or if farmers are using pumps. I mean, how do you basically provide a value for water so that the incentive to overuse water is gone? That's one. But in addition, there are also certain crops which are not tolerant of overuse of water. There, I think it's easier to explain that, you know, giving more water is actually not helping but harming you. So I think water use efficiency improvement has to be a central central concept, but it has to be backed up with adequate incentives. Then another point I wanted to say is that we also need to get a bit nuanced view of what water use efficiency means. So suppose a farmer is doing something like flood irrigation, and then we introduce drip irrigation. And because he or she was doing flood irrigation, they were only able to cultivate a small portion of the land. The moment we kind of, you know, they move to a highly efficient irrigation, it often happens that they can bring in more land under cultivation, which is not a bad thing, but overall, your total water use goes up. So you have to also, I mean, this is a kind of a very well-known paradox. So is the objective water efficiency, or is the objective water saving? We have to be clear on all those points.
Brilliant, Aditi. I think that's really helpful. Building on to what Madam Veronica said, you know, farmers implement practices, not policies. But what I'm hearing you say is that we need to orchestrate the incentives as well to drive certain behavioral change and choices by farmers. And we have to be deliberate about that. And before I come to the audience for some questions, I just want to throw a question at you, Lorenzo. I've seen that the WFP has recognized that ultimately to do the other work that you want to do beyond just providing relief, partnerships are important, right? Could you maybe share some innovative approaches that you guys are using right now to try and inspire these other actions, these other resilient actions by farmers beyond just receiving the relief from yourselves? Yeah.
Thank you very much, Mandla. I also wanted to add something about water efficiency. I mean, water efficiency also is highly dependent on how we use the soil. So, like, you can incentivize also appropriate soil practices that will actually make excessive use of water redundant. Like, you just don't need that much water anymore. So I just wanted to add this. In terms of projects, innovations, and partnerships, I think one of the biggest examples in terms of what WFP has been able to do in terms of land restoration and changing practices in a specific area has been in the across the five Sahelian countries, the G5 Sahelian countries, so Burkina Faso, Mauritania, Niger, Chad, and I'm forgetting someone. And Mali, yeah, thank you so much. In that specific context, through like integrated approaches, like WFP has been able, together with partners, like we've been partnering with 90 NGO partners, we've been working with FAO, we've been working with UNICEF, we have been able to restore 190,000 hectares of land since 2018, yes. And we have reached 2.5 million people in terms of food assistance and like an integrated approach that includes land restoration, access to markets, access to schools, and improvement of like basic services. And we've seen this, how it has changed many people's lives. We have seen in places like Niger, for example, that after the drought, like the one that we had last year, 80% of the population that was covered through this integrated approach with WFP was not in need of aid anymore. So these are the things that, I mean, to me, like, bring some hope for the future.
Exactly.
Although a lot of the hope is also resting what is happening in that plenary session there. But yeah, this is what we're trying to do, like working with more and more partners, integrating solutions, because like if we bring different activities together, like their impact is more than the sum of the single parts.
Exactly.
Like
exactly.
And plus, we're also seeing like bringing in also anticipatory action. So like anticipatory and early warning system that will like decrease the need of immediate food assistance by
exactly.
preventing, doing preventative action to avoid like the worst situation. And so this is more or less what we're trying to do.
Brilliant. Thanks a lot, Lorenzo. I want to turn to the audience now. I think what I'm hearing also from Lorenzo, which kind of reinforces the excellence in agronomy model, is that we need partnerships. There's no silver bullet. You might have a relief organization like this one because they can get close to farmers. If they get close to farmers with the right information to be able to help them learn new practices, you can have a scenario where after a drought, you've got an 80% reduction in farmers needing relief. So that's already resilience building, but it requires a combination of partnerships. It requires the right kind of incentives. It requires a very dynamic approach to policy formulation and implementation, and also giving farmers agency, because ultimately they are the ones that need to respond to the climate. As the audience, do you have any questions for the panel? I see Dr. Sattas, Dr. Govind, and yourself. So if I'm going to quickly run down and pass the microphone.
I'm Ajit from ICADA. It's a CG center focusing on the drylands of the MENA region and Central Asia. I just want to indicate that the term climate adaptation, as we currently use, it's a very, very broad area. And there are n number of climate adaptation possibilities in a given context. Let's say, for example, a farm in Nile Delta. So it's not one solution that exists. That may be like hundreds of solutions, so hundreds of climate adaptation practices are there. And farmers really don't know how to prioritize. I think there is a need to prioritize a package of climate adaptation solutions that we need to identify and scale it up. It's not, maybe it's a selection of variety. It may be enhancing the water use efficiency, or it may be other agronomic practices like diversification, for example. So I think we need to have a strategy of identifying a package of climate adaptation solutions that need to be scaled up. So we rather than mentioning broadly as climate adaptation. So this is one thing. And I think there is a slight mismatch of the priorities set by policymakers and the farmers in terms of climate adaptations. For example, just I can give you an example from the Nile Delta. The water use efficiency at the scale of the Nile Delta, it's very high efficient because the Nile water is reused from one farm to the other. But when we talk about water use efficiency at the plot scale, it may not be heavy efficient at all because it is flood irrigation compared to drip irrigation. So we have to look the term of climate adaptation from a scale perspective also. So I think these are some of my thoughts. Thank you.
Thank you. If you could pass the mic on to the gentleman next to you there. Thanks.
Thank you. My name is Amjad Babu. I'm from CIMIT. So I just wanted to ask you something about resource use efficiencies in a different way. We can look at it because farmers have a very short time horizon of decisions. You know that if you ask them about future, they act like there is no future for them. They act like they want everything now. They don't have the long-term perspective or vision. So it's also because there is no social security for them. So what I think is that many of these resource use efficiency questions should be reframed on what kind of future we are offering to them. And, you know, so I wanted to think about, the panel has to think about the question in a different way. How can we influence them and make them think in a long term rather than being a short term, you know, focused people? So that's my question. Thank you.
Thank you. Dr. Sattas?
Thank you. Thank you very much. My name is Murat, and I'm actually in an interesting space. I'm an innovation and
scaling lead of Climate Initiative, where we work heavily in Kenya. But also, I'm supporting a man line to deliver team in excellence in agronomy and heavily involved in the kitchen of scaling. So it's so such a pleasure to be here. What I want is, Ajit was saying, there are hundreds of possibilities, but in excellence in agronomy on climber, we develop strategies to package them. We have the, as Manla presented in the approach, like we have multiple technology, organizational solution, behavioral solution packages. My question, how we can make this integrate into Kenyan digital system? I know I started to learn, but I also, there's a lot of things done. So how we can integrate what we do into the existing system? And similarly, how we can service it to World Food Program for addressing different challenges. I think that is the missing link. If you can advise how we can service them to you, I think we can really address Ajit's question very well.
Thank you so much, Murat. So I'm going to ask my panel to make final reflections and feedback. But I'm going to start with you, Madam Veronica. If you could respond to Murat's question and then also wrap up in less than a minute, please. And then we'll come to Lorenzo, and then we'll end off with Aditi and Peter. If you could start, please.
Thank you. Yeah, in terms of looking at the farmer, telling the farmer to look at the future, I think it's up to the service provider to look at what benefits are there in the future. The farmer thinks about their next meal. So you don't tell, even when you tell them that you need to improve your soil, it's because when you improve it, it's going to give you a better yield. But you as the service provider know that if this soil is improved, it's going to be sustained, there is going to be sustained production. The other thing is also looking at, you see most of our farmers have learned to be subsistent. And they is like they only have, and that is a system that sometimes allows them to do that. But we need to be able to look at how, because that is what adaptation is. How can they sustain their livelihoods? It's not just about being harvesting a good yield today and not being able to harvest the next year because of a yes.
Yeah.
So that you. It is, we need to integrate, as you have said, those things. Then the issue of integration, I think there is great potential. Of course, we can't talk about it here. We need to get back home and discuss. Thank you.
No, that's fine. Thank you so much, Madam Veronica. Lorenzo, how do we bring scaling science into what you are doing?
Thank you. No, yeah. I wanted also to answer the question from the gentleman there. Like, what you're saying is very sad but very true. I mean, I've seen like in South Sudan, for example, like farmers that are working their land by slashing and burning, cutting down of the trees because they're looking on how to escape the coming lean season. So they're looking really like everything is from soil to mouth. So how do we change that? And we change that like by establishing social protection systems, by making sure that their kids, supporting their kids going to school, so that like on also working on land rights, because how can I invest in my plot of land if I don't know whether this land will actually be mine next year, or if I die, my wife will not be able to inherit that. I mean, these are some crucial things that we need to think of and we need to address.
100%,
And this is why we needed an integrated approach. This is why in many cases food assistance is needed, because if you don't tackle the immediate food security problem, farmers cannot actually think about anything else.
Correct.
So like we need to change this so that farmers can become again like the stewards on the land of
exactly.
the land. And hopefully also their sons and daughters will become the next generation of stewards and entrepreneurs of the land as well. So
100%.
This is,
Thanks, Lorenzo. Aditi, your final thoughts, half a minute.
Yes, yes. So as a CG scientist and as somebody who is deeply committed to the climate cause, I think my message is for ourselves. I think we as scientists have to be very, very humble and think of us ourselves as actually service providers. I mean, we are no different from, you know, what we call service providers, because our job really would be to see what is it that farmers required, was it it that ministers like Veronica require, you know, so and basically provide that. We cannot, I mean, the days, the 50 years ago, our model where we did things and, you know, we expected others to come and, you know, that is simply gone. So I think that's the, we have to really reorient the way we do science and do science in partnership and co-produce. So that's
unusual. Yeah, thank you. And then Peter, to wrap us up, your final thoughts, sir.
Awesome. Thank you very much. So basically, when I look at the African continent, I see, you know, mostly rural smallholder farmers. And when I look at, you know, kind of what Africa's contribution to global warming may be, it really comes down to the use of cooking fuel from firewood in such communities. And when I look at the amount of agricultural residues available and the ability to kind of use those recipes as a clean cooking fuel through special stoves and so on and so forth, and the outputs going back in the soil to improve yield, I think there is, you know, where the problem is actually where the solution is as well. Yep. When smallholder farmers are able to earn an income from their residues which can't decompose, it can actually be that social security system, because an income that comes in from residues that cannot be mulched can actually help pay for school fees, can actually help pay for food, you know, in off-season and so on. So I think let's focus on the rural smallholder farmer and let's look at them as, you know, a community that can actually be stakeholders, that can supply the global ecosystem and be the core for not just themselves, but also corporate growth as well. Thank you.
Well, I think I couldn't have closed it better. I do want to thank you as the audience for listening patiently, and I think some takeaway thoughts. I think what we are realizing is that, yes, agronomy is a useful tool, but if we're going to succeed, number one, we need to put farmers at the center of our thinking and solutioning. Number two, business as usual is not going to work. We need business unusual. Number three, there's no single bullet solution out there. We need a combination of solutions that are integrated to be able to help farmers. It's practices that they need, not policies. They need incentives, and we need participatory approaches, and also to consider that farmers need social protection as well. So thank you so much, colleagues, and please remember you can obtain this paper at the table over there, and please engage with us as we are still developing what should be an appropriate agronomic response to climate change for smallholder farmers. Thank you so much for your time, and have a great day further. And to my panel, thank you so much. Thank you.